Welcome back to the session. Now in the previous session we have seen x of n equal to u of n, x of n equal to a raised to n u of n, x of n equal to minus b raised to n u of minus n minus 1. So three questions we have seen. Now we'll talk something about the combination of both left hand side and right hand side sequence. Because in the previous examples the two questions were of right hand side sequence and one question was of left hand side sequence. Now I'll take the combination of these two. So the question is something like, determine the Z transform of x of n equal to a raised to n u of n minus b raised to n u of minus n minus 1. And we know that because of u of n, this becomes a right handed side sequence, and because of u of minus n minus 1, this becomes a left handed side sequence. So that's why we call it as both sided sequence, both from left to right. And also we need to find out the ROC for this. Now this is very important. We need to understand, we'll more focus on the ROC here because this is a peculiar type of a question. We have the ROC is something different or from the previous sessions or previous questions that we have seen. So given is x of n, instead of x of n we are being given with this value. So the question, the formula is simple, x of z equal to n equal to minus infinity to plus infinity x of n z to the power of minus n. Now we'll replace this x of n by this value, right? So the very simple thing that I've done is replace that x of n by this value, a raised to n u of n minus b raised to n u of minus n minus 1, which was given as the question. We'll now plot these two things. Now I'll try to add u of n and u of minus n minus 1. Then I'll try to see whether this is a both sided sequence or not. We need to understand this, whether this is a both sided sequence or not. So I'll start with u of n again. We have taken u of n and I have plotted this in the previous session, but again I'll just show it in a very quick manner how to plot u of minus n minus 1. Now this is u of n. U of n is a step signal which varies from 0 to infinity with a magnitude of 1. It is a discrete signal, so we have shown a discrete way or we have represented it in a discrete way. Now for n less than 0 it is simple 0. So if I try, this is u of n, this will be used now further also, and to plot this I need again this u of n. So for from u of n, if I try to plot u of n minus 1 according to precedence rule for shifting, so u of n minus 1, I have taken u of n minus 1. If I plot u of n minus 1, then this signal is pushed by 1. Pushed by 1 means n is pushed by 1. So whatever it was 0, it is now available at 1. Whatever it was 1 will available at 0, 2 will be available at 3, 3 will be available at 4 and so on. So at 0 now will be the value which was available at minus 1. See here, at minus 1 this was, there is no value. So no value will come at 0. So it is a clear cut shifting like this. Minus 1 to 0, 0 to 1, 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 is shown at 4, 4 is shown at 5 and so on. And then if I take u of minus n minus 1, u of minus n minus 1 simply means the reflection. So u of minus n minus 1 means the reflection of this. So this whole signal will be folded and put it here. Like 1 will be available at minus 1, 2 will be available at minus 2, 3 will be available at minus 3. This is what we have drawn already. You can see in detail I have shown there. Again just I am repeating it quickly. So this is a reflection of this signal. And if I add these two, u of n and u of minus n minus 1, so these two signals are added. So there it is 0. 0 plus anything is the same thing. So 0 plus all 1s will be all 1s on the left hand side, right? And then here from 0 to infinity, this is 1 but this is 0. So 1 plus 0 will be again 1. So you can see that from minus infinity to plus infinity now all the values are 1. So the values are available from minus infinity to plus infinity. So u of n and u of minus n minus 1, if they are combined, then the value of n exists from minus infinity to plus infinity. Or I can say that the magnitude will be existing from minus infinity to plus infinity. So our formula will be now carrying out from minus infinity to plus infinity. In the previous two cases, this was either from 0 to infinity or from minus 1 to minus infinity. Now in this case, this will be from minus infinity to plus infinity. So I have taken it as it is, as minus infinity to plus infinity a raised to n u of n minus b raised to n u of minus n minus 1 multiplied by z to the power of minus n, as just x of n is substituted here. So now this summation can be given to this as well as it can be given to this, or this is applicable for this and applicable for this. So we have taken it separately. So this summation is applied here also and this summation is applied here also. Rest of the things are as it is. And now these are to be solved with this as the second problem that we have taken and this as the third problem that we have taken. There is nothing difference, both are one and the same. as we have solved it earlier. So this will become from now this minus infinity to plus infinity will become from 0 to infinity because of this u of n, and u of n is supposed to be 1. So this becomes a raised to n z to the power of minus n, and in this case again u of minus n minus 1 is 1 from minus 1 to minus infinity. So from minus 1 to minus infinity this is again 1. So this becomes simply b raised to minus n z raised to minus n. So this whole value is a raised to n z raised to minus n, and this whole value is b raised to n z raised to minus n, because u of n and u of minus n minus 1 in these particular ranges are 1, that we have seen already in the previous question. So now we need to solve this. We need to solve this as it is, whatever we have solved earlier. So I am just going to solve this further, and then we'll solve both at the same time. This is az inverse raised to n as it is. Now this is bz inverse raised to n as it is. If I remove these two minus, now these minus has to be put up here somewhere, because I am multiplying this whole thing by minus. So minus of minus will become plus infinity, minus of minus will become plus 1, and this becomes minus n. So this is n equal to 1 to infinity or infinity to 1, because in the summation that doesn't make any difference whether it is from 1 to infinity or infinity to 1. So this becomes 1 to infinity or infinity to 1 minus of bz inverse raised to, because I have replaced this minus by plus, so this plus becomes minus, just the reverse of that. And if I take this minus inside, so this becomes if I take this minus inside, this becomes b inverse, and if z raised to minus 1 will become z raised to plus 1 if I take minus inside. So this is our equation number 1. Now this I have solved it in the two different as two different questions. This is our second question, this is our third question, what we have previously solved. If you are not understanding it, you can go through the previous question. So I am not going to again repeat the same thing here, because we have done it. The same question with the same conditions, we have already solved it. So just I have shown it here how to solve it. You can go through previous videos how to solve these two questions. So this is simply like 1 divided by 1 minus alpha, and this is alpha divided by 1 minus alpha, and if you solve it, then this is for z greater than a. See here. Now here the important thing is of ROC. For the right handed side sequence, the ROC will be z greater than a, and for the left handed side sequence, the ROC will be z less than b. Now we'll be more concentrating on these two things. Like if we take both the conditions, that z greater than a and z less than b, if I combine this, it can be written like this: z must be greater than a and z must be less than b. That is, magnitude of z is greater than a according to one condition, then according to one condition, the other condition it is z less than b. If I combine this, then combinedly this can be written as z must be greater than a and z must be less than b. So this is the combination part. So the important thing is how to plot the ROC. So there can be two cases depending upon the value of a and b. The value of a can be greater than b, or the value of a can be less than b. So the first case we'll take, that if the value of a is less than b. So there will be two circles now. One is at a, the other one is at b. Because the value of a is less than b, so I have taken it inside. The value of b is greater than a, so I have taken it outside. So it says that it should be greater than a and less than b. So greater than a is like this, and less than b is something like this. So the ROC will exist between these two points, a and b, greater than a and less than b. So it will now form a ring structure. I think this is very clear, that ROC is greater than a and less than b. It should not be less than a. So ROC will exist exactly with greater than a and less than b. So it will be between a and b. So this will form a ring structure, and the poles will exist at see here, z minus a equal to 0 is z equal to a, z minus b equal to 0 is z equal to b. So the poles will exist at exactly at z equal to a and z equal to b, and the zeros will exist at z equal to 0. Suppose if I take, or if in the question it is given that a is greater than b, then if a is greater than b, then a is needed to be larger than b. So a will become, a will be on the right hand side and b will be on the left hand side. So it is ROC is greater than a, so it will be outside the circle, and less than b, so inside the circle. Now we can see that the ROC is broken here, and ROC cannot be broken. So remember that ROC cannot be discontinuous, because here the ROC is broken, so ROC cannot exist. So thank you very much. We'll see this in detail when we'll be talking about the properties of ROC later. So if you have any doubt, then you can go through the previous sessions also. Thank you very much.